So, okay, so we're in chapter 10 doing parametric equations. And this is kind of a classic mixture to me of 10-2 and 10-3. In 10-2, we're looking at these crazy parametric equations. We're sketching graphs. But in 10-3, we learned how to do its derivative, which a derivative of a parametric equation, dy dx, is simply dy dt over dx dt. So we did this guy's derivative. It was easy. Dy dt over dx dt. We also typed it into my graphing calculator and sketched it. So there it is, I guess. But I got these cool questions. So check this. Let's work on this. So when is the derivative zero? Of course, the derivative is zero when the numerator equals zero. And if you move the 3 over and divide by 6, that's negative 1/2. So that's when it equals 0. And we do like to think of t as time, so that's when it equals 0. Where is this would be like a location, like an x and y coordinate location. How do I find that?
Plug it into the parametric.
Plug the t into the original parametric equations. That gives you an x and a y location. Mm-hmm. So if I can do that maybe on my calculator. It's helpful, it is helpful. If I've got this typed in my calculator, yeah. I can go to second, calculate, and ask for a value when t is negative 0.5. Yeah. And I am staring at the answer right now. It says negative 2.5, 6.25. You can get it by plugging negative 1/2 in there and working out your fractions. Turn them into decimals, but you'll get that answer. T is negative 1/2. If you plug it into the parametric equations, there's your point. Let me just and what's happening when the slope is zero? Oops, when the derivative is zero.
The slope is zero.
The slope is zero. Yeah.
Which means that
to me, that's kind of obvious. What I wanted another answer for what is happening on the graph then. Well, the slope is zero, that's true. There is a horizontal tangent line. That's the phrase I'm looking for, and that's what I mean when I say why. Why is it zero? Because there's a horizontal tangent line that makes the slope zero. I mean, that, yes. I mean, I don't know what causes what, but. At that point. That's right. At that time, at that location, this is what's happening. And then if I go look at this graph, I should sort of see that. At negative 2.5, 6.25, roughly there. I mean, sometimes it's hard to, but we're used to seeing horizontal tangents when they're maxes and mins, but sometimes on these curves, it's hard to see. But anyway, there's a horizontal tangent there, I guess.
Excuse me.
So we just found that one. So we did good. What's the other question? When is the derivative undefined? The derivative is undefined when the denominator equals zero. You factor out a 12, you got t squared minus 1, that's t plus 1 and t minus 1. The answer is t is plus and minus 1. I guess there's two times. I would like to know those locations. So that means I need to find those places. When t is 1, I could use my calculator, but it's easy to plug this in. When t is 1, negative 16, 13. Thank you very much. That's when t is 1, I think. When t is negative 1, I'll try to find another one. Zero, comma, seven. 0, 7. That's the other location. And if I go find those points on a graph, there's my graph. Negative 16, 13 is right here. Negative 16, 13 is right about here. It has nothing to do with the graph crossing over. It has to do with the slope being vertical right here. If the slope is vertical, it's called undefined. The slope is undefined. It's a vertical tangent line. It's not a sharp point or a bad point or a discontinuity or anything weird. It's just a vertical tangent line there. And then there was another one over here at 0, 7. This must be touching right okay. here. And there's a vertical tangent line right there. 0, 7. Huh. Yeah. So that's cool how analyzing the derivative, doing this analysis, doing this algebra or this cap, leads to those important places on the graph, you know. I'm going to answer this here. Why is the derivative undefined here?
Vertical tangent line.
Vertical tangent line. So, that's good stuff. I like that question, and we had done one like that Friday, and I just wanted to start with another one and make kind of make you work on it a little bit, but now I just helped you. Do you have any other questions, maybe from anything you've been working on in 10-1, 10-2, 10-3?
I have one.
Yes.
10-2, number 19.
Let's see about this. So in 10-2, she's asking about 19. Okay, so this is, okay.
I think I need those same marks when I looked at it.
Something threw me for a second, but okay, I'm done with this one, you guys. Can I get rid of it?
Yeah.
All right. So in 10-2, number 19, they give me these parametric equations. They use theta. If you don't mind, I'm in a habit of using t. I mean, we could use a variable called theta, but when it's an angle, but I like t. So I'm going to write x equals 6 sine 2t, and y equals
4 cosine 2t.
Now, this is good and classic, and so I'm glad you asked me this. Now, I mean, we had a big discussion on this, I think, Friday. We had a big discussion on this Friday. What is it? By the way, I don't know. Hang on, what's the question? Let's read the question. The question wants me to graph it, I think. Use a graphing utility to graph it. Eliminate the parameter and write the corresponding rectangular equation. They want me to show the orientation of the curve. I mean, I can do that without my graphing calculator, but I can use my graphing calculator also if I'm... But without my graphing calculator, I kind of wanted y'all to know what this was. We had these discussions Friday, so I'd like you to just tell me what it is.
Ellipse.
Good job. Yeah. Now, it's an ellipse. Now, listen, well, I think what we learned was when you put these sines and cosines on these x's and y's, that you get circular motion. Well, it's circular motion if these two coefficients are the same, because then it's a circle with a radius of 6 or a radius of 4. Well, when it's two different coefficients, that's what makes it a circle with two radiuses, or radii. Anyway, a circle with two radii is not a circle, it's an ellipse. Well, that's my thought process, and I tried to share that with you so you could have the same nice thoughts. You know, by the way, real quick, if I wanted a graph, it's centered at the origin, and in the x direction, it goes over 6 and 6. In the y direction, it goes up 4 and negative 4. So it is that ellipse.
My real question is how to eliminate the parameter when we have the 2t in there, because all of our previous examples have only been done with 1t.
Well, I'll show you. So, they did ask to eliminate the parameter, but guess what? We figured out it's an ellipse. We know it's an ellipse. We know a lot without eliminating the parameter. Eliminating the parameter just kind of confirms or proves to me that it's an ellipse, and it's a good exercise, and let's do it. What I would do is divide by 6, and you get this relationship. I would divide by 4, and you get this relationship. And then I do not really solve for t. I don't solve for t. What I do is once I get sine and cosine by itself, I use a good old, my favorite first grade identity I learned in kindergarten. that sine squared plus cosine squared equals one. And the truth about that identity is it's the angles have to match, and the angles can be anything. So whether they're t's or 2t's or 5t's, the sine squared of 2t plus the cosine squared of 2t does equal
one.
And with that thought, that means him squared plus him squared equals one. Therefore, on the other side of this equal sign, him squared plus him squared equals one. I mean, if sine squared plus cosine squared equals one, then this squared plus this squared equals one. And now you're staring at an ellipse, and you know that once you kind of take a look at it here. You're staring at an ellipse that goes over 6 in the x direction, 4 in the y direction, centered at the origin. Now, so eliminating the parameter is cool. It's an exercise you should know how to do, but I'm kind of past that. I'm trying to get you to recognize that's an ellipse without all those steps. But those steps might help you if you're lost. They help you think that it's an ellipse, I guess. The other thing they want is a nice graph, which we sort of did, but we want orientation. I kind of asked you to just memorize this, but, you know, you don't memorize things quite like I do. So if you typed it in your calculator, you would see it and you could tell the orientation, whether it's clockwise or counterclockwise. I tried to tell you that the typical ones are counterclockwise, and that's the ones where x is cosine, y is sine. So when they're switched, when x is sine and y is cosine, that's kind of atypical, and it's clockwise. And so it starts here, actually, and moves this way. But, you know, one thing that might help is just plotting a couple points. Oops, it's moving this way, clockwise. You could plot, what happens when t is 0? Where are you when t is 0? Good. 0, 4, 0, 4. That's what I sort of said. It starts there. Now plot another point and you might learn something. Pi over 2. Let's plot pi over 2. If I plot pi over 2, pi over 2 times 2 is pi. What's the sine of pi? 0. Pi over 2 times 2 is a pi. What's the cosine of pi?
1.
Negative 1. Negative 1 times 4 is negative 4. So where am I now? Oh, now I'm down here. Well, guess what? That's a little bit of an issue. I mean, can you tell the orientation by those two points I plotted? Wait a minute. No. Remember, I already filled in the orientation because I told you it's clockwise. But if you plot that point and that point, you don't know whether you went that way or that way, right? You need something in between, I guess. Sure. That would have been good. So the sine, that's a pi over 2 when you plug it in there. It's pi over 4 times 2. The sine of pi, that's a 1, that's a 6. And that's a 0. So that's this point at pi over 4. So again, I was right. We are moving this way clockwise. Again, I kind of memorized that, but if you don't memorize stuff, you can figure it out. Get your calculator too to look at. You got some points to plot just to see the direction of increasing t, which is the orientation of the curve. There it is. 15 is one of my favorite little problems. I'm just in 10-2 here, and in 10-2 you're just trying to, you either pick up a calculator or you do something to figure out what this is. In 15, it's x equals, secant theta, y equals cosine theta. Hang on. X equals secant of theta, y equals cosine of theta. Okay, anyway, this time I did write theta, but theta could be your t, okay? It could be t, they just use a different letter. They did add some other notes here. What did they say about theta? They said theta had to be between
0 and pi over 2.
0 and pi over 2. They're leaving out pi over 2. Theta is between 0 and pi over 2. They're leaving out pi over 2. Then they're saying theta is also between pi over 2 and pi?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is kind of funny, a little statement they're giving me here. Again, I could pick up my calculator and try this. That would be cool. I have to type this in correctly and play with the window, and you know, I could do all that. I could also just use my brain. You know, what if you eliminate the parameter? It does kind of help to eliminate the parameter sometimes to help you see, that helps you see the path, you know, what are you, you know, like this one. When we eliminated the parameter, we were an ellipse. We already kind of knew it. But, and with the trig functions, you tend to use trig identities. Do you know something about secant and cosine?
Secant is 1 over cosine.
Secant is 1 over cosine. They are reciprocals of each other.
Right.
All right. Well, that means that the x and the y are reciprocals of each other. How do you write that?
Y equals 1 over x.
I like that. If you eliminate, the relationship we got here is this. If you eliminate the parameter, this is what you get. I did that quick. You're not convinced, are you? Are you convinced? You need more convincing? I mean, that x is a 1 over cosine. The y is a cosine. That kind of makes me want to write x equals 1 over y, doesn't it? That makes me want to fill the y in there and write that. But guess what that is? Multiply by y and divide by x, and that's this. These are all the same. They're reciprocals of each other. So it's the same thing. All right, what's y equals 1 over x? Well, that's actually a very famous graph. We've been working with it, you know, a few times this semester. Y equals 1 over x is this kind of famous graph here. Y equals 1, here's the other piece of it here.
It stops somewhere in the middle line.
Good. This is y equals 1 over x. But when we travel on this path with this parameterization, we probably have some restrictions, like, you know, cosine never gets bigger than 1 or lower than negative 1. Cosine lives, only spits out numbers between negative 1 and 1. So that means y has to live between negative 1 and 1. Y has to live between negative 1 and 1, so this whole entire piece of the graph is not here. And this entire piece of the graph is not here. We're traveling on that path, but we're only traveling on this portion of that path. That was beautiful. That was smart. That was cool. Your graphing calculator would know all this, I think. Your graphing calculator, if you type those in, and it would be smart enough to know all this. It would. Let's plot a point. When t is 0, where are we, please? When t is 0, where are we? When you plug in a 0, and by the way, it's theta. Sorry, instead of t, it's theta. Plug in a 0, and you get, nobody knows the secant of 0. What's the cosine of 0? 1. And the secant of 0 is the reciprocal.
One.
So it's 1, okay. So it's 1, 1. We're at the point 1, 1, baby, that's right here. That's that. So, okay, so it sort of starts there. And then I bet you it probably moves this way. And when it gets to, look, and then remember, here's what they gave me this. I think what happens is when you get to 90 degrees or pi over 2 or 90 degrees, or pi over 2, when you get to pi over 2, it's, what's the cosine of pi over 2? zero. And if that's zero, and he's the reciprocal of zero, the reciprocal of zero is undefined. You could also maybe say it's infinity. Well, hang on, I'm getting there. So I'm suggesting we got t equals zero, we come out this way, and we go to infinity. As we go to infinity, we approach this x-axis like an asymptote. We never touch, we never cross. And when are you officially at infinity? When t is pi over 2. Whatever the hell that means. I guess I'm saying, when you're at 89.9 degrees, you're way the hell out there. When you're at 89.999 degrees, you're way the hell out there. As soon as you hit 90 degrees, you've disappeared. You're undefined, and you're no longer anywhere. As soon as you get to past 90 degrees, 90.1, 90.0001, boom, I think you jump up here. All of a sudden, you're way out here, and you're headed in this way. And when you get to 180 degrees, or pi, I think you're here. Let's plot pi, t equals pi. What happens when t equals pi? Anybody know the cosine of pi?
-1.
What's the reciprocal of -1?
-1.
So you're at this point, -1, -1, when t equals pi. From 0 to pi, you start there, you go off, you hit a black hole. At pi over 2, you hit a black hole or a wormhole. Phoop! Come into the other side of the universe. Phoop! I mean, it makes that noise, too, when black hole. Whoop! Phoop! Anyway, you come in on this side, and you hit here at pi. Then what happens? No, you said... I mean,
it goes back the other way.
Oh, well, you do stop if you follow those directions, because those directions sort of said stop at pi.
Yeah.
But if we kept going, I think it would turn around right here, go start going the other way.
Oh, wow.
And at 3 pi over 2, it would hit that black hole again. Boop.
And then come on the other side.
And show up over here. Boop. And comes cruising in this way. And get back here. And when is it back here?
2 pi.
Yeah, it's completing its cycle. It's completing its cycle.
Oh, wow.
In a period of 2 pi. I mean, I like that one. That's an interesting little graph. It's got this undefined t value, though. T equals pi over 2. We're undefined, and I'm calling it a black hole. But... I mean, these things are cool. Again, we travel these paths, and we travel on these paths in these funny ways, depending on the parametrization. You know, I guess I like playing around with these things. The real use of these, we haven't really done any word problems, but the real use of these is... And I know you guys aren't really in that physics class yet. I mean, you might have had some physics at some point. But one of the first things you do in physics with calculus, and they don't even use the word parametric equations, but you launch a projectile. You talk about projectiles, and you start up here at a height h, and you launch it with some initial velocity at an angle theta with the horizontal, and it takes off, and it takes on this parabolic path, and it lands somewhere, maybe. I mean, you launch projectiles, and you analyze the heck out of them. And what you do in physics, though, is you do it as a function of time. And you do it as two separate functions. You consider its x distance as a function of time. And then you consider its y distance as a function of time. And you never really think of it as a set of parametric equations, maybe. But that's what it is. It's x as a function of time, and it's y as a function of time. The formulas are simply, well, let me say something. In physics, they would say you start at some initial x, and you have a velocity in the x direction, which is this times t. And you have acceleration in the x direction, which is this. Are you with me? This is kind of the general way to talk about a motion in the x direction. There's an initial x distance, there's an initial velocity in the x direction, and there's an acceleration in the x direction. Now hold on a second. If we're talking about launched projectiles, the only acceleration is good old gravity. And gravity acts in the y direction. There is no gravity or any acceleration in the x direction, unless the projectile has some kind of motor on it that's pushing it in the x direction. But usually you launch it and it goes, and the only acceleration is gravity in the y direction. So this x formula tends to turn out to be, now watch this. By the way, on my scale, where's the initial x position? The initial x position.
Zero.
So this is a zero. This is V naught cos theta times t, and that's a zero. So it kind of boils down to this for your x in this picture. I'm sorry, I just took a complicated x equation and made it easy because there's no acceleration in the x direction. And we started it at zero. Okay, but for y, it would be the same equation. Look, y would be y naught and v naught sine theta t. That's the y velocity, initial velocity. And then a over 2 t squared. But this time, let me write what y is. Y is, that y naught is going to be h plus v naught sine theta t. And here we go. If this is gravity, and if we're on Earth, it's negative 32 feet per second,
right,
if we're doing with feet. Divided by 2 is negative 16 t squared. So this is kind of the classic parametric equations here for a launched projectile. In physics, they kind of talk like this, just in case you have some acceleration in the x direction. They put a little subscript. This is the acceleration in the x direction, the acceleration in the y direction. I mean, if it's really a launched projectile, that's zero and that's gravity, right? But if it's, could be some other movement, it's not like a launched projectile. But are you guys all right? Mm-hmm. anyway, I'm trying to tie this into your physics class that you might see next fall, I suppose. But you'll do this the first few weeks and you'll work on these projectile motion problems. I assigned one in the end of 10-2 that makes you work and think a little bit, but I mean, it's a good problem, but I don't know if I'm going to work too hard on this. One interesting question, I'm just going to leave you with this one. I'm not going to do it for you. Could you please eliminate the parameter and prove that this is a parabola? But anyway, I guess it'd be, I said I was going to leave it with you. Now, as soon as I ask a damn question, I want to do it. I mean, can you eliminate the parameter? I mean, look, look, there's a lot of letters up here. All these letters are constants except for x and y are variables and t is the parameter. But everything else is sort of pretend they're constants maybe. So how would you eliminate the parameter maybe? Solve for t.
Right.
If you can get, that's usually sometimes how you eliminate the parameter. You solve for t and then you get x over v naught cos theta, and then you plug that in for t down here.
Yeah.
Right. And then I think when you plug it in for t, then instead of t's, you'll have x. You'll have an x and an x squared, I guess. That sort of proves it's a parabola, I think. Anyway. You can eliminate the parameter and get the x and y relationship if you wanted to. But
what we have is these two parametric equations that define x distance in terms of t and y distance or height in terms of t separately. And in physics, when you do word problems, you kind of do think of it separately. You think of it kind of separately. Depends on the problem. Okay, so I just wanted to get that thought out. Let's see. I'm kind of ready to move to a new area of thought, unless you got any questions. You still got any questions? All right, let's do this. What happens is I'm at the end of class, and I can just kind of barely get you started into this next section. But this next section is a whole new world, you guys. It's polar coordinates. I mean, check this out. This is wild. This is a pole. This is a polar axis. What you do in this world is you start at the pole and you walk out a distance r. These polar coordinates These polar coordinates are a two-dimensional coordinate system, but it's not x's and y's. It's r and theta. And here's what you do. You walk out on this polar axis, you walk out a distance r, and whatever r is, 3, you walk out 3, and then you rotate an angle theta, whatever theta is, 30 degrees, and you rotate like an angle is in measured in standard position, which means kind of from the polar axis counterclockwise is how you measure an angle. So if I said 3, 30 degrees, where are you? You walk out 3, and then you rotate 30 degrees, and you're right there. That's that point. 3, 30 degrees. What about 3, 90 degrees? That would be walk out 3 units and rotate 90 degrees. Oh, there you are. This is a whole new way of thinking, dude. It ain't X and Y. X, you know, how does X and Y work? Oh, you move over X and you move up and down Y. That's cool. It's always served us pretty well. But now we got polar coordinates, which means you walk out this distance R and rotate this angle theta. And can you imagine how it works? You know, you can get anywhere. First of all, you got to convince yourself that you know how X's and Y's work, and you know they work. You know, if you wanted to get anywhere in the XY plane, you can do it. Negative 1,000 X and 400 Y, or you know, you can get to any location. So does this method work? Can you get here? Yeah, you just gotta walk out the appropriate numbers of R's, which by the way, that R would sort of be, I mean, if R is 3, then that's 3, that's 3. I don't know what that is. 10, maybe. And then you just gotta have the distance R from the pole and the proper angle, whatever it is. There's an angle that'll get me there, you know. I don't know what 220 degrees or something. So it really does work, this new coordinate system. Now here I am playing with what I call a pole and a polar axis. The truth is, I will never talk like that again. I mean, what I really do, I mean, I'm trying to talk like that because we're in this new coordinate system called polar coordinates. And I'm trying not to bring up X and Y. But to help us think better, what we do is we take this pole and polar axis and we superimpose it on top of our good old X and Y axis. I mean, that's how we really do it. So, but maybe I don't want to label it X and Y, but anyway, here's the pole and a polar axis here, if you don't mind. And of course, 90 degrees would put me here, and 180 degrees would put me here, and you know. So I'm using an X and a Y axis to help me with my angles and my distances, kind of. Is that okay? So can we find the point 2 pi over 4? And I said, walk out 2 and then rotate pi over 4. Is that what I said? Mm-hmm. Well, you could do it backwards. Maybe backwards is even better. Rotate pi over 4 and then walk out 2. Maybe that's better. Rotate the angles pi over 4, which will put you on a radial line right there, and then you walk out 2 units. You know, that's 1, 2 units, whatever 1 and 2 units are. You know what I mean? There you are. If this angle is pi over 4 here, 45 degrees. I mean, it's just a point. It's just a point. There it is. It's not x and y. R and theta now. Here's the funny thing about polar coordinates that they're not unique. They're not unique. That's the proper phrase. I mean, there's another name. It's funny. It's kind of weird. There's another name for that point. That never happened in rectangular coordinates, by the way. If you were in rectangular coordinates, if you were at the point 3, 4, there was only one name for that, 3, 4. In polar coordinates, there's a couple of names for this point here. The reason there's a couple of names is because of the cyclical nature of angles. The way, instead of calling that pi over 4, is there another way you can get to that angle? Negative 7 pi over 4. Again, you might not be too great at your unit circle, but a negative angle. So the same r, but a negative 7 pi over 4. You know, and that's not really, I wouldn't call that the same angle, that's wrong, but it lands in the same place. The word for that is it's coterminal. It terminates. So that angle is coterminal with that angle. You know, r is this distance we walk out from the origin, and then we rotate this angle theta. So it's weird to think of r as being negative, but it can be. And if r is negative, then instead of walking out in that direction, what I do is I walk backwards. So that means I can even name this another name for this point. There's a lot of names for this. This is this one point, you guys. 2 pi over 4. Do you see it? I walked out 2 and I rotated pi over 4. Now, there's another name for that point. There's a name for it. There's another name. What if I went to this place? What's the name of this angle? By the way, here's a better name. What's the name of this angle? That's 5
pi over 4.
Yeah, that's 5 pi over 4. Okay. 5 pi over 4 would put you here, but instead of walking out 2, what do I want to do? So it's like I rotate 5 pi over 4, but then instead of walking out 2, I walk backwards negative 2. Okay. So there's another name. Here's another name. There's one more. I mean, actually, there's millions because you can add another 2 pi to any of these, right? Can you add 2 pi to any of these angles and land in the same place? Add or subtract 2 pi to any. So let me do one more. This one. What's the name of this one? If that was 5 pi over 4, this was negative 3 pi over 4, right? And then walk backwards negative 2. All those are this point. So it's a little weird. Yes. One point can have several addresses, so to speak. What we do is we practice converting from rectangular coordinates into polar coordinates and vice versa, back and forth. We convert back and forth. And it's so easy. the relationship between x and y and r and theta is very easy. Look at this picture. I just said, so if you want to get to this point, back in rectangular coordinates, you would go over x, you'd go up y, and there you'd be at this point. Right, you guys? I mean, you get to that point by going over x and up y. Well, and how would you do it if you were in polar coordinates? You would rotate an angle called theta, and then you'd walk out this distance called r. Do you agree? So that the same point could be called r theta, or it could be called x, y. It's a point. But from this picture now, you can see these relationships. It's easy. You know, this is a right triangle, and therefore x squared plus y squared is r squared. And I could say that the tangent of theta is opposite over adjacent, y over x. Or said another way, theta is the tangent inverse of y over x. Are you guys okay? I mean, these are very obvious equations that sort of just come from this picture. It's easy, right triangle trig picture. And so these relationships between these variables aren't mysterious. They're very easy. X squared plus y squared is r squared. Here's another one. Here's another one. Watch this one. I'm going to say this. X is r cos theta. I'm going to also say that y is r sine theta. So these equations come straight out of this picture. Now, these last two I wrote down. Is that bothering you? I wrote it down quick. You didn't get too long to think about it there. Are they not as obvious? Were those more obvious? Is this less obvious? Maybe this is obvious. If you move this r over, what you see is, how about this? Look at the picture and tell me the cosine of theta. What's the cosine of theta? X over r. What if you multiply the r up there? There you go. You got this equation. You with me? So these aren't that mysterious. You know, what about the sine of theta? What's the sine of theta? Opposite over hypotenuse, y over r. If you multiply this r up here, then you got these two cool equations here. So when you first get used to these polar coordinates, well, we're asking you to do some converting sometimes, like this. Watch this. -3, 5 is a point in rectangular coordinates. Please convert to polar. All right. Well, so that's my x and y. You know, maybe I'll draw a little picture of it real quick. X is -3, y is 5. I'm up here, right, you guys? This is my point. Now, all I need to do is figure out r and theta. By the way, the answer is not unique. There's several R's and thetas that'll get me there. I just learned that a few minutes ago. There's several, R's and thetas that'll get you there. So I don't know. What do I do? What was given? X's and Y's were given. I don't think I need these formulas. I think these are for going the other way. I think when X's and Y's are given, I can, I think I need these. Can I find R? 9 plus, what's r? R is the hypotenuse. What's r? Yeah, x squared plus y squared. Wait a minute. X squared plus y squared is r squared. Yeah, so that means r squared is 34. Is that what that is?
Yeah.
So r is square root of 34. It's easy stuff. Easy stuff. It's a distance, and I just leave it like that, almost 6. Can we find theta? It's not a pretty theta. I didn't make this pretty. But the tangent of theta would be the y over the x. The y over the x. And then the theta would be the tangent inverse of that. You guys okay with this? The tangent inverse of y over x. I'm just kind of using the formula. Trying to come up with some polar coordinates for this point. I got r. R is easy. It's just the hypotenuse. Theta is the angle here. It's that angle, kind of. Or, well, hang on. This is it, except what does your calculator tell you when you do this? And I'll tell you what, do me a favor. Let's do this in degrees, just to be more comfortable. Can you put this in degrees and tell me the tangent inverse of negative 5 over 3?
59.036.
What'd you say?
Oh, wait.
That's all right.
Negative
59 degrees. All right, negative 59 degrees, people are saying. That's negative 59 degrees. Okay, thank you very much. Is that right?
No.
No, negative 59 degrees is in quadrant 4. I mean, it is right. It's the right related angle. It's the right reference angle, but it's in the wrong damn quadrant. I'm in quadrant 2. What do I do with a negative 59 degree angle? How do I adjust it? I mean, that's not the answer I want. I need to.
You need a negative r.
I have 180.
Well, no. I'm here. I'm trying to find this point.
Right.
I chose this positive r, so now I want that angle. The calculator spits out that angle. But I'm not in quadrant 4. I'm in quadrant 2. I need to make an adjustment. What do I do? It is the right reference angle.
Add 180.
It's exactly, yeah, I didn't maybe get, add 180 degrees and you'll have the right. So if you add 180 degrees, what's the answer?
121.
Sorry. 121. Thank you. Now that's not that difficult. That's a little area of math, though. I know students, I always got to help students with this, always, all my life. Your graphing calculator, when you punch in tangent inverse on your calculator, tangent inverse is restricted. It has a restricted range. And it only spits out angles between 1 and 4, between negative pi over 2 and pi over 2. No matter, tangent inverse will only spit out angles in quadrants 4 and 1. It's all it ever does. And it's got this restricted range, and the calculator's been programmed to understand that restricted range. So that's the answer. And it's the correct answer, but when we're working with something else, when we're over in quadrants 2 or 3, we gotta make the proper adjustment by adding pi. And it happens, like in this problem, it happens in other funny problems in different places when you're working with vectors and stuff. It's a common little thing that kind of gets students. You gotta watch out. You can't totally trust your calculator. When you use tangent inverse or sine inverse, sometimes you gotta, because they've got a restricted range of only certain quadrants, and you might be working in a different quadrant, and you might have to make it a little adjustment. Hey, we found the answer. What's the answer? I was asking for a point. I was asking to convert this point into polar coordinates. Do we have an r and a theta?
Yes.
Square root of 34, 121 degrees. We did. Good job. By the way, there's other names for that point. That's a good name. Listen, I only got 2 minutes, and I want to talk fast. Listen to this. What did I just do? Give you a point and tell you to convert it to polar. Watch this. Here's an equation. Here is an equation. Let's convert it to polar. So converting points is okay, but get past that quick. Converting equations is kind of what you want to do.
And do you have any formulas over here that might help you convert this into polar?
The x and the y are...
Well, there's an x and a y, so everywhere there's an x, I can replace it with... And everywhere there's a y, I could replace it with this. That would be the long way around. Do you see any other formulas?
Oh.
It would work, though. It would work, but... Right. So in other words, r squared is 9. And take the square root, and r is 3. And we don't need the plus and minus here, if you don't mind. I'm just going to say r is 3. This is so cool, I only have a minute to describe how cool it is, so I better do a good job. Now, this is so cool because this is our damn nemesis. You know, I mean, it ain't much of it. What is this? It's a circle of radius 3 centered at the origin. I mean, it's not that bad, but when you solve for y, he always sucked. I mean, when you solve for y, what was he? Plus and minus the square root of 9 minus x squared. Remember trying to integrate him? If you ever try to integrate him, you have to do trig substitution. It's a nasty integral. I mean, circles are not cool in rectangular coordinates, but all your life you've had to deal with them. I mean, they're not that bad, but they're in rectangular coordinates and they're a little cumbersome. Dude, look what his name is in polar coordinates. That's his name. You know, if you think about it, all right, I'm going to have to talk more about that next class. That's his name. I mean, that's his name. In polar coordinates. R equals 3. There is no theta. Theta can be whatever it wants. Theta can be whatever it wants, and R is stuck on 3. And that creates a circle, don't you think? If R is stuck on 3 and theta gets to be whatever it wants. And why do I say theta gets to be whatever it wants? Because there's no theta here. So when theta is missing from the equation... Theta just gets to be whatever it wants. R is stuck on 3. That creates a circle. Centered at the origin, radius 3.
So you just call that R equals 3 for that equation.
That's the equation. You know, remember this y equals 8? What's y equals 8, you guys? Horizontal line, y equals 8. That's its name. It's very simple. That's its equation. In polar coordinates, R equals 3 is this,
it's that circle.
Is this circle, right?
With the center at 0.
Yes. All right. I'll see you Wednesday, I guess. You can ease in.